morning, I invite you, as we continue in our series through the Psalms, to turn with me to Psalm 13. Psalm 13. And as we look at Psalm 13, I'm going to ask you, those of you who are able to stand, to do so as we listen to God's Word out of reverence and respect for the one who speaks to us this morning through His Word. Stand then, if you are able, as we hear God speak to us through the Psalm, Psalm 13. Hear these words from the Lord. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer me, O Lord my God. Give light to my ears, or I will sleep in death. My enemy will say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Today we're going to talk about forgetfulness because the psalmist believes that God has forgot about him. All of us experience forgetfulness. On any given Sunday morning, it can hit me. I'm here and trying to greet people and call them by name and they walk in and I say hello and I forget their name. It doesn't, there's no recall. I'm thinking of 100 names and I know it's not the right one. Sometimes we are supposed to remember something that's important, and so your wife tells you, honey, help me remember that. And we get in the car, we get down the road, and we get to the place we're going, and we say, did you remember? Oh, I forgot. Well, you were supposed to remember to tell me, because now I forgot as well. Forgetfulness is part of life. It happens all the time. Sometimes the thing we forget are big things. Sometimes they're small matters. They're irrelevant. Sometimes when we forget, the consequences are huge. And other times, there is no consequence to speak of. It's just simply the fact that we forgot something. But today we're going to ask a different question. What is it like when we ask someone else to remember and they forget? What happens when someone else forgets? It's not me, but it's them. How do we respond? What do we do? The psalmist is asking, what am I to do when God, it seems as if God has forgotten me? This is the question that is churning and burning in the heart of David. He says, how long, O Lord? How long will you forget me forever? If you were to look at Psalm 12, and you can look at that later today, in Psalm 12, another psalm that David wrote, he is thinking that all of the people have forgotten God. That all of the people of Israel, it seems like everyone in Israel, in his kingdom, has turned away from God and forgotten God and left him. And he's sort of given up on them. In some way, he's sort of thrown his hands up and said, what am I supposed to do with these people? Much like Moses did one time. But he says in Psalm 12, but at least I know that I have you, God, that you are still here with me and I can trust in you. But now in Psalm 13, that has changed. He's questioning. He's asking. He's saying, I'm afraid, God, that you have forgotten me, that you have disappeared. Where have you gone? What are you doing? Have you ever thought that God has forgotten you? You may be saying, wait a minute, Pastor. Are we allowed to ask such a question? Is it okay to say, God, you have forgotten me. I think you have forgotten me. Or would, if, when saying it, am I going to be struck by lightning? And if we do ask the question, does it reflect a lack of faith on our part? Frank Thomas, a pastor and a writer of commentaries, shares this story. It's a story about an elder who comes to the council with a report, and he says, I have been meeting with this young woman. She came to me and she was extremely down and depressed, and she came for help. She wanted someone to pray with her and provide spiritual support. And so I have called the elders. We have gone to her. We have laid hands on her. We have prayed over her. We have anointed her with oil. We read scripture to her. We prayed with her. We gave her some devotionals for her to read so that she could daily be engaged with God's word. We shared with her some songs that would lift her heart and her soul to God and remind her that God is there watching over her. We've tried everything. But it seems as if this woman is stuck, that she can't get out of this state of depression, that she is still down and not well. She's overwhelmed and she's carrying this burden around. And so he said, so I asked her these questions. Do you believe that God would lie? And the woman said, no, I don't believe God would lie. He said, do you believe that God could be wrong? No, I don't believe that God would ever be wrong. God is truth and he's always right. Do you believe that God is good? Yes, I believe that God is good. And then she said, but I believe that God can forget about me. And then she asked the elder, do you believe that God could forget about you? Do you believe that God could forget about you? It happens. It happens more often than we would ever realize or acknowledge. People that are Christians, people that are walking in step with God, people that believe that Jesus is their Savior, that God is their Heavenly Father, and the Holy Spirit is working in their hearts, and they are trying to walk in step with that Spirit, they come to a point and a place in their life where they ask the question, God, have you forgotten about me? It's happened to me. It happened to David. It happens often when we go through a period of life where we find ourselves in a trial, when we are being tested, when things aren't going the way that we want them to go or the way we had hoped they would go. And as the time drags on, the burden becomes heavier. We believe that David wrote Psalm 13 when he was being hunted down by Saul. David had already been anointed king, but Saul was still the current king, and so Saul knew that David was going to replace him, and he was trying to kill him. And so David was in hiding, running, hiding for his life. It happens. It happens in marriage. The honeymoon is over. You now have 2, 3, 4, or 5 kids. You have little time or a little money for each other to do the things that you used to be able to do. And marriage doesn't seem like much fun anymore. It's just a lot of hard work. And you ask, how long do I have to do this, God? when is my life going to get better? It happens in our work. You loved your job initially. You had dreams of moving up the ladder. Or your business that you started was following the plan that you had for it. It was growing and you had dreams of expansion. And now it has expanded to the point where you wish that you could have the days when it was just a little small business, where you didn't have all the headaches, all the worries, all the concerns. Or you've climbed the ladder, but now you're stuck. And work is not enjoyable anymore. But you don't know what to do, and you don't know where to go, and you're just going to work every day miserable. How long, O Lord? How long will you forget about me? It happens in church. It happens with pastors regularly. We serve a broken people. We are called to serve them. And at times we cry out and say, how long, O Lord? When am I going to see the fruit of the Spirit clearly evident in the life of my flock? It happens to people in their spiritual life where they do the up and down and up and down, and sometimes they find themselves in the low point and they can't seem to get out of it. Do you remember Elijah? Elijah on Mount Carmel? God called him to speak out against the prophets of Baal, and he said it will not rain, and it didn't rain for 3 years, not a drop, not a speck of dew. And so now there's this confrontation on Mount Carmel. There's an altar built up, and he tells the prophets of Baal to bring fire down upon the altar, and nothing, they do everything and nothing happens, and God, Elijah prays, and suddenly a cloud appears. Actually, the prayer was that rain would come, and the cloud appears, a little wisp of a cloud. And it comes and it rains, and fire comes down on the altar, consumes it, and Elijah kills all the prophets of Baal. Victory! I won! I showed you who God is. But there was no ticker tape victory parade for Elijah. There was no thousands of adoring fans waving him on and saying, way to go, Elijah. No, it was just Elijah alone. He felt alone. Except the enemy was still there. Ahab and Jezebel, who wanted to kill him now, were still there. And so he ran and he hid. He felt alone. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? The psalmist is saying, it's almost as if you're doing this on purpose. Really, God, are you getting satisfaction out of turning your face away from me, making me feel miserable? I know you've blessed me before. Why can't you bless me now? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts every day and have sorrow within my hearts? How many of you have found yourselves in a prolonged trial, a prolonged difficulty, and you've done everything in your power to reconcile, to work it out, to make things better, to overcome, to get out of the difficulty? And yet the struggle prolongs. When that happens, our minds begin to play tricks on us. We begin to think things that are not well or not good. We wrestle with our thoughts. Should have I done that? Should I do this? What if I do that? What's going to happen now? And we are in a tumultuous turmoil. There's no peace. And the anxiety and the chaos grow and grow. We wonder if we're going crazy. We think we might be going crazy. We might be losing our minds. The great sermon writer, Charles Spurgeon, suffered bouts of depression. And oftentimes that's what happens. We become depressed. We just get so low, we become depressed. Charles Spurgeon, the great writer suffered with bouts of depression because he experienced the pain of gout much of his life, and it never went away. Young mothers experience this. They can't get any sleep because of their newborn child. And their newborn baby is colicky and cries during the night and won't let them get any sleep. And they cry out, how long does this have to go on? It's been weeks. Now it's been a month. How long is this going to continue? This blessing, this thing that I was looking forward to, this baby that I was longing to hold, has become a burden. And I don't like it that I feel that way. How long is this going to go on? And our mind starts playing games with us. And the enemy, when we are at our weakest point, then the enemy steps in. It happened to Jesus. Remember when he was after the glorious baptism, where John the Baptist baptized him, and the dove descended upon him, and the door of heaven was open, and the voice of God spoke and said, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. Oh my goodness, what a grand and glorious event. But then immediately, Jesus is transported by the Spirit into the wilderness, and after 40 days of fasting, when Jesus was at a physically very weak moment, the enemy shows up. With his smile, with his happy tricks and lies, trying to make life better. That's what happens. When we're at our weakest moment, that's when the enemy steps in and starts to confuse us. And so David cries out to God and says, how long? How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? So if we find ourselves in one of these moments, when we actually think that God may have forgotten, when we actually wonder, God, are you going to show up? Because I need you really badly. What are we to do? Well, you notice what David does. He calls out to God. He challenges him. He says, answer me. Look at me. Give light to my eyes. Let me hear you. Let me see you, so that I may know that you are still here with me and that you have not forgotten me. What David is doing is he's challenging God. He's saying, you are a God who has made a covenant promise. You are a God who is faithful to his promise. And if you are not going to be faithful to your promise, then you can no longer call yourself God. So answer me. Look on me. Give light to my eyes so that I may see. Because without you, if you're not with me, I am going to die. Because without you, there is no life. Without you, there is only death. And so he challenges God to show up. He prays to him. Desperate times call for desperate measures. Now, what made it possible for David to cry out to God? It was the Spirit of God working in his heart. That little dim light that is shining in David's heart yet. It turns his heart toward God, and he cries out to God in a desperate plea. And God shows up in a whisper. Just enough to fan the flame so that there is faith still evident in David's heart. Listen to these words from 1 Samuel chapter 3. Now In those days, the word of the Lord was rare, and there were not many visions. The lamp of the Lord our God had not yet gone out. So God hadn't showed up with words from prophets. He hadn't showed up in visions, and so people were beginning to wonder, where is God? Is God still with us? But the lamp of the Lord had not gone out. The lamp of the Lord never goes out, and it continues to shine in the heart of David. And his turning point is it makes him possible to set the craziness of his life aside, the worries and concerns that have caused him to cry out, "How long, O Lord? How long have you forgotten me?" To lay them aside and to say these words: "Yet I will trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation, and I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. I will trust in your unfailing love. I will still trust you. I will put my faith in you, even though I can't see it at the moment. And my heart will rejoice in the fact that you have saved me, that you have claimed me as your own, that you have delivered me. And because of this, I will sing to the Lord, for you have been good to me. You have, in the past, I can recall your goodness. I can recall your favor upon me, even though I don't really experience it now. And so I trust that that same favor, that same goodness that I experienced in the past will come to me again. I believe that you will be good to me, that you will bless me, that I will have 10,000 reasons to praise you." Now, the message of Psalms of Lament are this: just because we cry out to God in times of need, in times of trial, in times of distress, doesn't mean that God's going to instantly deliver us and transport us out of our trial. No, he reminds us that he's with us, that he will not abandon us, that he will walk with us through the trial. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." The valley of the shadow of death isn't simply people getting close to death. When we experience trials and difficulties, it's the shadow of darkness. It's the shadow of death, the shadow of Satan, putting out the light that we're supposed to shine. And we all experience those times. Just like the psalmist, "I will fear no evil, for you are with me." David's problem isn't going to disappear instantly, but he trusts in God. And so the challenge this morning is, as the title says, who is forgetfulness should we be worried about? David is concerned that God has forgotten him. But in reality, the truth is that God never forgets. God never leaves us. That he's always with us. And so the person that is forgetting, the one who is struggling with forgetfulness, is David. He has forgotten this momentarily. Just like we do at times. Momentarily, we forget that God is with us, and that we have to simply put our trust in him and seek him while we lament, while we cry out, "How long, O Lord? How long will you forget me? But do not forget that God does not forget us, but that God is with us, the God of Jacob, the God of Isaac, the God of Abraham, the one who sent Jesus, who did not forget, and he will not forget. Let's pray. Father in heaven, there are days in our life where we struggle. There are times when we have burdens that we carry, some that we brought on ourselves, some that simply came to us. We live in a broken world. And sometimes we find ourselves in distress. We try to do what's right. We try to do what's good. And yet, it seems as if bad things happen. And life is just wrong. Today we cry out with the psalmist David and say, "How long?" But we do not say, "Have you forgotten us?" We ask that your Spirit would remind us daily that you do not forget, that even though our trials may be long, that our difficulties may continue on, that you are there with us, that you walk with us through the trial, that you walk with us through the difficulty, and that we can draw strength and courage and hope from you, and that you will not let us down. And so we praise you, O God. We put our faith and trust in you. And we thank you for being faithful to your promise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.